Well, hello, good evening, and welcome to worship this evening. If you're visiting with us, particularly warm welcome to you this evening. As we prepare our hearts for worship, let me read to you from Psalm 145. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. Let's pray. Our Father, as we come to you at the end of this Lord's Day, we come to you as our Father in heaven. We thank you for the gracious way in which you've taken us into your family, by your Holy Spirit indwelling us, and by uniting us to your Son, the Lord Jesus, in whom we have redemption, even the forgiveness of our sins, and by whom we come freely and boldly before you in prayer. Grant, we pray, that tonight that you would engage our minds and our hearts, that our affections would be gathered up and directed towards you, that we would love the Lord our God with all our heart and soul and mind and strength, that we would find in this evening around your word and in fellowship with one another a time when our minds are lifted up and exalted, and we are able to comprehend something more of your greatness and your goodness and your glory. We pray that you would exalt your Son and draw us to him. In him we find everlasting life, and through the knowledge of him, we come to the knowledge of you, our Father. So be with us now, we pray, in all our acts of worship. We ask in Jesus' strong name. Amen.
Pray a prayer of confession using the words that you'll find in your bulletin. God of grace, you love us, but we have not loved you. You call, but we have not listened. You speak, but we have not heard. You summon us, but we have not answered. We walk away from neighbors in need. By our actions and attitudes, we condone what you condemn. O merciful Lord, we admit our sin and turn to you in full repentance to ask for your gracious forgiveness. Restore us to full communion with you. Quicken our hearts to hear you when you speak, to be diligent and faithful in reading your word, the Bible, and to respond when you call us to take action. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. Now hear the gospel's assurance of pardon. You were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. Seated.
My scripture reading this morning is for this morning. I'm in the wrong time zone. This afternoon is from Song of Solomon, chapter 3, which, if you're using the Church Bible, can be found on page 561. Song of Solomon, chapter 3, and we're going to be reading the first five verses. But before that, we do that, let's go to our Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, as we have just made in our confession, we pray that indeed you will help us to be diligent and faithful in reading your word. This is not a religious textbook, but rather it is the word of the living God. And what we desire is to hear your voice through the reading of this word, through the preaching of your word, through the singing of your word, yes, and even through the prayers. We come before you, asking to hear of your voice that we may live. Come be with your people. Open our hearts as well as our minds to hear you speak. For it is in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Song of Solomon, chapter 3. Again, this is the bride who is speaking. She is giving words to her dream. On my bed by night, I sought him whom my soul loves. I sought him, but found him not. I will rise up now and go about the city, in the streets and in the squares. I will seek him whom my soul loves. I sought him, but found him not. The watchmen found me as they went about in the city. Have you seen him whom my soul loves? Scarcely had I passed them when I found him whom my soul loves. I held him and would not let him go until I had brought him into my mother's house and into the chamber of her who conceived me. I adjure you, O daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles or the does of the field, that you not stir up or awaken love until it pleases.
Jesus.
me in prayer. God, you are most merciful and gracious. We have received your blessings. Now we ask that you accept our offering. Remember in your love those who have brought it and those for whom it is given. May you use it to be a blessing to the world and to advance your kingdom on this earth. Amen. You may be seated.
Do take your Bibles and turn to Song of Songs, chapter 3, the passage we read together earlier. While you're doing that, I mentioned this morning and I mentioned again this evening that our presbytery and the session of this church are very eager to ensure that the church of Jesus Christ be a safe place, especially for those who are abused in one way or another. We recognize there are many ways in which people find their lives tortured by abuse, emotional, spiritual, physical even abuse. And so the presbytery has called, and we are hosting a conference with Dr. Diane Langberg, who will be the speaker on the 1st of May, Tuesday the 1st of May. Oh, sorry, that's not the date. June the 23rd, Saturday, June the 23rd. But Tuesday the 1st of May is the last day for early bird registration. So if you go online or call the office and ask for Helen, you'll be given the details. There are also, I think, cards advertising the conference. Very significant that we are aware of what this looks like so that we're able to identify those who are suffering and how best to respond so that we don't respond in the wrong way, in a hurtful way, but rather in a helpful way to people in those circumstances. So I do commend it to you. I think it's important for as many of us as possible to learn what we need to learn on these matters. Well, we come back to the Song of Solomon and the hymn we've just sung, one of those hymns which I can't sing it really without tears in my eyes. Jesus, the very thought of thee takes me back to my childhood, takes me back to the very first impulses of spiritual life in myself. The desire, I think, from the very early age to have the kind of relationship with the Lord Jesus where these words are the words of my heart. And I'm sure many of you identified with those words, and particularly verse 4, what to those who find this, nor tongue nor pen can show the love of Jesus, what it is, none but his loved ones know. Because there are times, you know, when you're speaking to people, it was for me at school and still is, that words run out, that your ability to articulate your love for the Lord Jesus is such that you can almost, and I have these moments where I can't speak. You may say, that would be a good thing sometimes. But where the emotion is too so great, the feeling is so palpable, that it's almost impossible to put it into words. And how wonderful then that God should have given us a book in the Bible which, while using human categories of love, uses them to describe something that is indescribable in any other terms, that takes us further than our human experience, deeper into the nature and character of God himself. And in this little vignette, this little section, this mini poem within the wider poem of Song of Solomon, we have a little insight into what it is for those who find Jesus. And the interesting thing is that it starts with someone who's looking for Jesus but doesn't find him, seeking and not finding. Well, there are seasons, you see, in the church's life, because I think the bride in this story is primarily the church, but by extension, it's the people of God who make up the church. Originally, the author would have been thinking of Israel. Israel is the Lord's bride, the bride of Jehovah. And then in the New Testament, the bride of Jehovah is, we discover, the bride of Christ. And there are seasons in the life of the church, and in the life of the believer, there are these ebbs and flows of our enjoyment of our Christian experience. Of course, we know that Jesus never leaves us. Yeah, he promised that, didn't he? He never leaves us nor forsakes us. But having that promise and knowing that that is the ultimate reality, that the Lord Jesus never deserts his people, disguises another reality. It's the reality of our experience of his love and our enjoyment of his presence. There is what the Puritans called the feeling sense of the presence of God, the feeling sense. And often the feeling sense is gone, while objectively we know that he will never, ever leave us, nor forsake us, and that nothing ever can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. There are times when we don't feel that. Many of you perhaps have not felt that for some time. And why should this be? Well, we ask that question as if God had some obligation to make us always feel comfortable in and pleasant in our relationship with him. That is not an obligation on God. And we ask it sometimes forgetting that there are other things at work in our lives that we dare not forget. For example, that God the Holy Spirit has a great project to make the church and the people of God holy. And so many of the things that happen to us are part of that project of the Spirit to make us as like the Lord Jesus as it's possible for us to be this side of glory. One of God's ways of making us more holy, one of God's ways of working out our sanctification, that is the making holy of us in this life, are these repeated visits and withdrawals of our experience, of our felt sense of his presence and power in our lives. Sometimes the feeling sense of God's presence is something that we don't look for, and it comes unannounced, it comes suddenly, after some absence perhaps, without our seeking it. It comes perhaps in a time of worship, a time of meditation, a time of thought. God uses means to get our attention, to reassure us of his love. We had a description of that kind of sudden event in chapter 2, the voice of my beloved, behold, he comes leaping over the mountains. Before we know it, there he is. He has spent all his power, as it were, to get to us right where we are and to, as it were, be in our face and be present with us. He takes the initiative. Sometimes he takes the initiative to those who are not really looking for him, not really searching for him. Isaiah the prophet, you'll see that there are great connections between the Song of Solomon and the book of Isaiah, which immediately follows it in the canon, deliberately in the providence of God. But in Isaiah 65, God says, I was ready to be sought by those who did not ask for me. I was ready to be found by those who did not seek me. I said to them, here I am, here I am. And I spread out my hands all the day to a rebellious people. There are those who are not looking to him or for him, who nonetheless are found by him. But then there are times, as in our passage today, when it seems that we must wait for the feeling sense of his presence. In these verses, we see the believer and the church seeking him, pursuing him, and finding him. We see the church, first of all, seeking him in the darkness. On her bed, the bride is seeking her absent bridegroom. It's night, and all is dark. She's seeking him whom my soul loves. That's important. She has not lost her sense of their relationship. She has not lost her knowledge of his love for her or of her love for him, the believer. We're talking about the believer here, the church. She is convinced of his love for her, and she confesses her love for him. Like all believers, as Jesus said, she loves the Lord her God with all her heart, all her soul, all her mind, and all her strength. And even though she feels distant from him, she will not let him go. She keeps him in her mind. Though he slay me, yet I will trust him. So what is she doing there in the darkness? The psalmist explains for us in Psalm 63, I remember you upon my bed and meditate on you in the watches of the night. She is contemplating in her mind the one she loves, her Lord whom she loves. She's troubled. She cannot be comforted. In the language of Psalm 77, I said, let me remember my song in the night. Let me meditate in my heart. Then my spirit made a diligent search. That's what's going on here. Here is the spirit of the believer, the imagination of the believer, the heart of the believer seeking God, seeking to think about the things of God and to contemplate the things of God. The church is drilling down, as it were. The believer is drilling down to discover more and more about her beloved Lord. And when we are first Christians, perhaps, or young Christians, or we're going through those seasons in our Christian lives where our relationship with the Lord is particularly acute and real and active and vital, you will know those moments. You've tried to imagine your relationship with Him. You've read the Scriptures. You want to pray. You use what you've read to address Him, to speak to Him. You've imagined Him replying in the very words of the Scripture you've just read. What are you doing? You are contemplating Him. Perhaps you try to get your head around some of the things that you are being told about Him. Now that's what's happening in the text. It's dark, and in the dark she's contemplating things that cannot be seen. She is searching in her imagination for the one who is invisible. Sometimes the Lord clothes Himself in light. Other times He makes darkness His hiding place. She has an understanding of Him. We have an understanding of the Lord tonight in this room. But she wants to know Him better. We want to know Him better. We want to press into the darkness, that is, the areas of our mind that have not yet been illumined with understanding, that need to be illumined with more understanding. More light needs to shine into the darkness of our mind and our understanding. She is pressing deeper into the invisible, leaving the world of sense behind. She is seeking to know Him. In the words of Gregory, she seeks to know what His essence is, whence He has His beginning, where He comes to an end, what it means that He has existence. She's thinking about God and wondering. We wonder sometimes when we sit down for a moment, instead of thinking about the Christian life merely in terms of a series of duties that we have to perform moment by moment and day by day, and we get away from the busyness that we keep on urging each other upon to do, as if the whole of the business of the Christian life was what I do for Jesus. But when we stop for a moment and we think about God, and we think about the Lord Jesus Christ, these are the questions we ask. What are you made of? What are you like? Where was your beginning? You had no beginning. Where do you come to an end? There is no end. By what means do you exist? I know how I exist. I'm a creature, and I'm a dependent creature. But God, you are so different. We try to engage with the God who has revealed Himself in Scripture. We contemplate it. That's what she's doing. She's thinking about Him. I sought Him, whom my soul loves. I sought Him, but I found Him not. Gregory says that at that point she knew that there was no limit. No limit to the understanding of God. No limit to His splendor, to His glory, or to His holiness. And that's very often what we do. We do that ourselves on our own in the night watches when we wake up in the middle of the night. And instead of worrying, we decide we'll talk to God about the things that are on our minds. Or we'll draw back to our memory, what we heard in church on, on Sunday, or what we read in the scriptures, or what someone said to us, perhaps. We draw these things through our mind, and we want to bring our attention to God in Christ. And sometimes we can do that easily, other times we can't. Other times we're going nowhere. Other times it's all dark. It's dark in our minds as well as dark in the room. We're perplexed by the thought of him, and our thoughts wander down other paths. We focus on our feelings, we focus on our ignorance, we focus on our sin, our joys evaporate. Our faith is tested. But there's something else to take into consideration in this little section. John Owen has written, one of the great Puritan authors and theologians, has written on our communion with God. That is our fellowship with Christ, the relationship we have with him. And in his chapter on the glory of Christ in the mysterious constitution of his person, John Owen quotes this very passage, and he adds this: "The Lord Christ is pleased sometimes to withdraw himself from the spiritual experience of the believer." The Lord Christ is pleased sometimes to withdraw himself, notice, from the spiritual experience of the believer. Not taking himself away from you in terms of being, but in terms of your experience. That is, in those moments, he's not giving you any vibes. He's not communicating to you any of his comforting grace, to use Owen's expression. Of course, I quite understand that you may be here this evening and you've never had an experience of these things. You've never had any refreshing communion with him. And therefore, you're not really conscious of his absence, because you've never known his presence. Owen goes on and he says this: "But those whom he has visited, to whom he has given of his love, with whom he has made his abode, whom he has refreshed, relieved, and comforted, in whom he has lived in the power of his grace, they know what it is to be forsaken by him, even if just for a moment." Do you even know what I'm talking about? Don't answer out loud. Our distresses increase when we look for him eagerly in the ways we've been used to finding him. How are we used to finding him? Perhaps in our quiet time, if we have one. Perhaps in the worship service. Perhaps through the preaching of the word. These are the normal ways that we find him. And sometimes we go through these motions and nothing is happening. Nothing is getting through. We're doing the motions. We're doing the duty. We're following the habit of meeting together, as the Bible encourages us to do. But we're not getting anything out of it. There are times like that. The hard moments of the soul. The dry moments of our Christian experience. And what we are to do there is not to give up. She's still looking. I sought him. What she's doing, she's using the church, the believer, is using prayer and meditation and reading and hearing the word and all the ordinances of divine worship in private and in public, and is seeking by diligent obedience to find him. Are you looking for him this evening? Well, phase two of this little section is pursuing Christ, seeking Christ, pursuing Christ. It is a biblical principle. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. And the church and the believer is blessed when they give themselves to this task. Ambrose, one of the church fathers, says this: "We see the heavenly mysteries represented allegorically," is the word he uses. I think we would use the word typologically, on earth through the gospel. And he points us to the story of Mary Magdalene. You remember Mary Magdalene is beside herself in grief because our Lord has been taken away from her. She and the other woman, they get up while it's dark. They go looking for him in the dark. They make their way to the graveside in the dark. They arrive at the graveside when the dark is just beginning to end and the first glimmer of dawn is beginning to pervade the semi-darkness. And when they get there, there's no Jesus, but there's an angel. And the angel says to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, he is risen." And a little later, Mary Magdalene is standing there alone now. The other women have gone back to get help. She is standing alone in the garden. She is weeping and she sees a figure and she supposes this figure, still dark with just glimmers of light, she supposes him to be the gardener. And she says to him, "Where have you put my Lord?" He says to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" And in our text, you see, the bride says, "I will rise now and go about the city, in the streets and in the squares, and I will seek him whom my soul loves." It is a prefigure. This little verse is almost a description of what Mary and the other women are doing on that resurrection morning, looking for him, not finding him. He's not there because he's risen. The closer Christ is to you, the more you will want him in your mind and heart. And it's a disappointment and a discouragement, but it will not dissuade you from looking. Here now she is pursuing Christ. Now some have understood this spiritual pursuit in the broadest terms. We have to think about who it is we're pursuing. We're pursuing the Lord Christ. We're not pursuing the Lord Christ in his human nature. We know that we're not going to encounter the Lord in his human nature this side of glory unless there's the second coming. So when we look for Christ tonight, what are we looking for? We are looking for him in his divine nature. We are looking for his divine presence with us. The bridegroom is incomprehensible, therefore, in his being. In his divine nature, he is invisible to us. In his divine nature, there are no limits to his nature, to his presence, to his splendor, to his glory, to his holiness. So wherever you are, he is there. He's put the Holy Spirit in your heart and he's promised you not only the Holy Spirit will come to you, but the Father and he, the Son, will come to you. You cannot escape from him. He is there. You're just not feeling that he's there. And so when you start to pursue Christ, you remind yourself that what it is you're doing. And so some of the fathers talk about this search through the city and so on as being a kind of search through all intelligence and all super cosmic nature, thinking, where can I connect with him? How am I to picture him? How am I to imagine him? How am I to get a hold of him? And the mind, as it were, can soar through the universe. You can imagine the principalities and the powers and the rulers and the lords and the various gradations of angelic beings. And in imagination, in her heart, she pursues in curiosity to find more understanding, more grasp of this beloved. She traces through every intelligent form of life and every philosophical and scientific paradigm, looking to find her beloved, her Savior. And perhaps you're on a search like that. You've heard about Jesus. seems a bit disconnected to your reality here. You think, well, he died back then, and even if he's alive, he's certainly not alive and sitting in the church here this evening. So when you talk about having a relationship with Jesus, what does that even mean? And what can it mean to you? Because it's not anything in creaturely reality. As the divine Son, he is everywhere, present, inside and outside of creaturely reality. He is incomprehensible to us. Maybe you've gone down every intellectual highway and byway to try and find the truth, and still you're reaching a dead end. What you're seeking is beyond your grasp. Don't you understand that is your answer? You cannot put words on what it is you seek. You cannot imagine what it is you seek. It gets beyond your grasp, because it is beyond your grasp. To think that God the Son is more present to you than the people you're sitting beside in this room, and that he is always totally present to you, wherever you are, and at whatever point of time you find yourself in. It's incomprehensible to us. And it's because this one who eludes you is incomprehensible in who and what he is, that he is the one in whose case every conceptual unit is an obstacle to its discovery for those who seek it. Those are the words of an old church father, Gregory. Every conceptual unit is an obstacle. Every philosophical approach that you find is an obstacle to you finding him, because it cannot comprehend him. It cannot contain him. Therefore, she says, I sought him, but found him not. Well, I urge you not to give up the search. Here is one who sought and did not find, at least for a time. Why might that happen? Well, sometimes he withdraws to see if we notice. Talking to believers here. Sometimes he withdraws to see whether you notice. Sometimes he withdraws from churches because he's been marginalized. The churches began to believe that while they say the creed, nonetheless, the Lord Christ does not really need to be too involved in the life of the church. In the book of Revelation, there are a series of letters sent by Jesus to churches in which he complains about the churches. He says to one, you've abandoned your first love. He says to another, you have got some among you who hold to the false teaching of Balaam, and another group who are holding to the false teaching of the Nicolaitans. He says to another, you tolerate that woman Jezebel who is teaching immorality. To another, he says, you have a reputation for being alive, but you're dead. And to another, he says, I know your works, that you're neither hot nor cold. And in every one of those churches, Jesus is not present. And he's saying to people in the church, if anyone, any individual, any believer within the church hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come in. This is what the Spirit says to the churches. That's one reason. Sometimes the reasons for his withdrawal are that the muscles of our faith might become stronger by use. So she searches for him. She doesn't find him. And then in verse 3, the watchman found me, she says. The watchman found me. That's very interesting, isn't it? Who are these watchmen? We know that when we're talking about heaven, the watchmen are the angels, but here these watchmen are human. Now you take that word. This is the Bible, so when a word like this is used, you ask yourself the question, where in the Bible is this word used, and of whom is it used? It's principally used of the prophets and of the shepherds, that is, the elders, the overseers, those who care for the souls of men and women. And the element of the prophetic, of course, is an emphasis, I think, that in terms of translating it to us this evening, the ministry of the Word of God is a prophetic ministry. In Isaiah 52, the voice of your watchmen, they lift up their voice. They tell you what God wants you to hear. Isaiah 62, on your walls, O Jerusalem, I have set my watchmen all the day and all the night, and they shall never be silent. Talking about the prophets. In Ezekiel 33, you I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from me, you're to tell them. That's the work of the watchman. And at the end of Hebrews, when it's talking about those who've got spiritual oversight and responsibility for the churches of Jesus Christ, it says, they are those who watch over your souls as those who must give an account. The watchmen are to look for anxious souls. The watchmen are to give themselves to the study of God and the knowledge of God and the administration of the gospel mysteries. The word they bear, the word we preach, is a sign and seal of the promises of God. It is a sacramental word. It carries with it the very power of God to accomplish what you need in your life. Preaching is a bridge to you for eternal life. She's pursuing Christ. And the watchmen come along and they help. They must help because, thirdly, she's finding Christ. Look at the way it's put in verse 4. Scarcely had I passed them when I found him, whom my soul loves. You see, the watchman can only tell you where he is. The watchman can only point you to Christ. But you cannot build your faith on them. They're only the instruments. But you follow their words. You follow the words that take you beyond the whole of the created order to the place where faith and faith alone may lay hold of the beloved and hold on to him and will not let him go. That's what we have described here. She found him. Faith found him. Faith took hold of him. Faith grasped him. That's what faith does. It makes him ours. It lays hold of Christ and takes him into the chamber of the heart. If you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord. If you believe in your heart God's raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Just like Mary, just like those women who after the resurrection when they met Jesus in the garden took hold of him and would not let him go. You remember? They would not let him go. He had to peel them off him. They were holding onto his feet. Prostrate before him, amazed that here he was alive after his passion. And when, after a period of absence, we find Christ, we reach beyond the things of time and sense, the things of this passing world, and we find him whom our souls love and lay hold of him. We don't want to let him go. We want to keep that moment, that magic moment, in our minds and our hearts. She held on to him and would not let him go. And she takes him into the mother's house, to the chamber of her who conceived me. In the Bible, the mother of God's people, Jerusalem, Zion, the holy city, is the bride of Christ. is the wife of Jehovah, is the church. The church is our mother. It is in the church that we're born, born again, brought into the family of God. It's in that home. That's where we are conceived by the Word of God. And she gives a warning in verse 5 to any of those who would drive him away. She warns anybody who has it in their head that they're going to disturb the peace and purity of the Church of Jesus Christ against disturbing that peace and driving him away. Those who find Christ should be concerned for the interests of God's people, his church, that she may have Christ present with her and be earnest in prayer for his presence with his people, with his ministers. Those who enjoy his company should desire that the church should always enjoy his favor. Bring him with you to church. Anyone who has an ear to hear, let him hear. Here I stand at the door and knock. If you open the door, I will come in. And then bring him with you into the church, that we might share together our fellowship with him whom our souls love. As for those who find this, nor tongue nor pen can show the love of Jesus, what it is, none but his loved ones know. Let's pray. Father, this evening we ask that you would make our Lord Jesus so preciously real to us. Some of us are more aware of our feelings and our emotions than others. Some of us, Lord, by nature find it hard to have a sense or a feeling. Will you reassure such this evening that sometimes your way with us is to present yourself to our mind and to enlarge our mind and our understanding of you? And in that way, to engage us, perhaps even just a moment as in the sermon or when the choir is singing or we're singing with the congregation or praying together. Will you give us those sweet moments, rich in blessing, which before the Lord we spend? We pray in Jesus' strong name. Amen. now may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you until that day we gather together in that sacred Jerusalem and forever glorify God. May God be with you. Amen.